In 2017, I was approached by a team of designers to help finance a project they were doing here in Greece. The aim was to reuse old fishing nets and turn them into filament for 3D printers. I thought the idea of recycling marine plastic waste into something workable was absolutely fantastic. So I started working in my mind the idea of how this could actually be reused. We put together the best minds in the fields of marine plastic waste, new technologies, and circular economy, and dove right in. We have a storage area just outside of Athens, so we started suggesting to various friends in NGOs and various other companies who had been collecting marine plastic waste up to that point, that we take them back to our storage area. This material, up to that point, had been taken to the landfill. Come to think of it, 5 years later, we might have gone a little bit overboard because we've collected more than 500 tons of material from 30 locations around Greece. We've also been trying to see if we can find a solution to the problem of marine plastic waste through mechanical recycling. The problem that we are faced with, marine plastic waste, is huge and it's global. When we think of marine plastic waste, we usually think of plastic nets and plastic bottles and bags floating in the sea when we swim. We sometimes might even think of the billions of microplastics that are ingested by seabirds and fish, and we know humans as well. However, we do know that there is a much larger killer out there. Every year, more than 140,000 animals, large animals, whales, dolphins, turtles and other animals are killed by ghost nets. Unfortunately, it's not only just animals, it's stony corals, other reef organisms that are killed when the heavy nets fall and poison the fragile ecosystems below. Globally, 640,000 tons of fishing gear are lost every single year. This number is crazy. On a more local level, Greece has the largest fishing fleet in the whole of the European Union with more than 14,000 fishing vessels. It's closer to 15,000 today, actually. Of course, this doesn't mean that all of these nets are lost at sea, God forbid. However, it does mean that the number of nets used every day, specifically in Greece, as well as other countries, is very large and can no longer go unnoticed. Included in these types of nets are mussel farm nets, aquaculture nets, we have many abandoned farms, unfortunately, in Greece as well, and monofilament lines used by professional and amateur fishermen alike. Unfortunately, Greece, together with other European countries, lacks the facilities and the infrastructure to collect this waste and do anything with it. From the 640,000 tons which is lost every single year, less than 1%, 1.5% is successfully recycled. This is such a disheartening figure, which we've tried and we've been planning to see if we can change. The reason is that it's an arduous process for the material to be collected all around the area, brought to one location, sorted, cleaned, and further processed. As I said, this is the number that we try to change, so we thought about intervening and doing just that, see if we can change this number. So the first step is to collect the material and bring it back to one location where it's categorized by its cleanliness. The range is quite large, it goes from amazingly clean to extremely dirty. And the second step is for this to be categorized by plastic type, so whether it's nylon, polypropylene, polyethylene, or any other type of plastic. Of course, we have many different colors as well, so the next step is for this to be categorized by its color, and we end up with something like 180 different samples of material. Of course, then this is washed in order for it to be recycled into pellets and hopefully turned into recyclable and traceable products as well. We started making pellets back in 2020, which we were very excited about. We thought it was we were very excited with our results, but we also wanted to see if we could use it for something else as well. What else could we? What other types of applications we could use? So we started working with the idea of large-scale 3D printing. 3D printing is an ally for the circular economy exactly because it produces less waste and it allows for more design customizations. The production and the manufacture process is a lot more accurate and efficient. However, after having done these two applications, we still were not entirely happy and we wanted to explore what is the highest safety standard of plastic that we can achieve? What is the cleanliness of plastic that we can achieve? So we decided to focus on food products. Plastic for food. In the European Union, however, the highest level can only be attained by PET plastic, so the type of plastic that we find in our bottles or single-use plastics every day. As our nets are not from this type of plastic, we knew we couldn't achieve that, so we decided to focus on the second highest standard instead, which was children's toys. So we went ahead to make children's toys made out entirely of fishing nets, which comply with the highest safety standards in the European Union. Of course, this is the highest level of cleanliness. However, we do have tons and tons of material which unfortunately cannot yet be successfully cleaned or sorted. We've also been trying to explore various ways that this can be reused by making building materials and hopefully allowing us to find more ways that this can be reintroduced. Here we can see a set of tile which is made from the dirtiest of marine plastic waste, the type of waste that has been lying in a beach for many years or clawed under a rock. One might wonder why we would do something that is so time-consuming on one hand and so expensive as well. Should we be investing in various innovative projects when a break-even point is actually so far off? Not only do we believe that we should be doing it, we also believe that we must do it. This is actually a leap of faith that we should all be taking together. There are two main goals in what we do. By making these pellets, we would like this material to be re-entered into the plastics industry. By reintroducing recycled plastic to the plastics industry, we hope to achieve a decrease in the production of virgin plastics. If the current rate of virgin plastic continues production, by the year 2050, 20% of oil consumption will go directly for the production of plastic products. The second goal is the fact that we want to raise awareness on the dangers of this particular type of waste, but also to highlight the fact that this isn't waste at all. In creating large quantities of waste, we have managed to create huge resources of new materials. Think about how many things we use every day. I'm not talking about the devil that is single-use plastic, but what about things all around us? Our homes, our gardens are made of plastic. The uses are actually endless. So we should be able to take plastic recycling from marine plastic waste from the craft stage into the industrial stage. All of these items around us have a very specific end-of-life date. The end-of-life date is when we decide that this item is no longer useful for what we bought it for and now belongs in the garbage, which actually I think it's quite funny because it sort of implies that there's a different planet for garbage altogether. Many times we see plastic that comes labeled as waste from production sites or from other various sources that has mere hours of use. It's younger than brand new. It has almost never been used. This is insane on one hand. On the other hand, we have fishermen who, out of fear of disclosing their fishing grounds, which is extremely Greek if you ask me, do not disclose the location of the nets that have been lost, even if they're not the ones that lost them, and even if it's been their legal obligation to do so since 2009. So if you think about this broad spectrum, the end of life truly is whenever we say it is. A very familiar sight around Greek islands, which you might see, you've all might seen many times traveling, is mountains and mountains of nets drying on the side of the port. These are normally dried, repaired and reused in many cases, probably not these ones. However, that's the main concept of putting nets on the side of the port. We also do know, though, that this is the most common way of disposing of these nets. Cleaning up the nets from this type of waste, cleaning up the ports is one thing, but also what we've been trying to do is highlight the particular qualities of this material. We have to remember that this is extremely high quality material that comes from applications which require extreme tension, such as shipping and fishing, and we know that the quality of the material is extremely high, so it's practically begging to be recycled. Taking a step back, I'd like to look at the circular economy for just a minute. What we've had, and what we had for almost 200 years now, is a linear economy which follows the take-make-waste approach. The take-make-waste approach basically means that we take something from the Earth, we make something out of it, and then we throw it away, I'm assuming, to planet garbage. Of course, this can't continue any longer, because we know how much resource depletion has been instrumental to climate change. On the other hand, talking about a circular economy, we've been asked to reduce our products, reduce our resource dependencies, our environmental footprint, and our waste. Another quite important aspect of a circular economy that is not so often talked about is the importance of redesigning items. So why would we redesign something that already works? The reason is that since we started designing all our products, we've been designing waste as part of the equation. We are the ones that designed it in, so we should be the ones to design it out. What we should be doing instead, if we follow a circular economy concept, is that we should be taking from what we have, from what we've already extracted from the Earth, reusing to the extent that we can, focusing on services rather than products. So instead of constantly buying new things, how about we focus on sharing and renting schemes instead? And finally, follow the journey of the waste from beginning to end. By tracking the life cycle of the material, we're allowed to follow the waste streams better and see what enters the streams and what can be successfully made out of it. Making items in the context of a circular economy is basically asking several questions one after the other. What is it made out of? How much waste did it produce? Can it easily be recycled when it reaches its end of life? So basically, what happens to it after it dies? Which, quite frankly, what we should be asking is what happens to it after we die? Does it have the same value? Does it have the same usefulness to somebody else? And thinking about its value is extremely important because somewhere along the way, we seem to have stopped valuing everything and started throwing everything away. We should remind ourselves of some concepts that until today haven't been disproved. That we are all part of the same chain and inhabitants of the same planet. The polluters and the cleaners, the industrialists and the environmentalists, and the makers and the takers. Although we won't be here for the next 200 years, the items that we make probably will be here for 200 years if they're made from materials such as plastic. So we should finally ask ourselves, who are we making them for? Is it just us? Is it our communities? Or is it our children? An environment free of plastic waste should be a commitment that we all undertake for generations to come. Thank you.